welcome to our panel on pedagogy and faculty research. I'm your moderator. My name is Brian Lander. To start, I'd like to ask you all to introduce yourselves and say something about how teaching the studio affected your own research.
Hi, I'm Margaret.
It is.
You have to, it's not our thing that loud, it's just recording. Oh, okay. I'm Margaret Crawford. I taught the Los Angeles Identity and Mobility in Los Angeles Research Studio and Art and Village and City in the program for Delta. The first one with Ann Walsh from the Art Department, the second with Wendy Wong from Rhetoric. And I really can't say that it has affected my research that much. I did find an interesting site that has been incorporated into my research, so that part is interesting. But I would say it's a teaching experience. It's very rewarding and actually fun. Probably one of the best teaching experiences I've had. So, Greg.
Hi, everyone. My name is Greg Chrysler. I'm in the Department of Architecture. I taught the Mexico City course, as it was being referenced a little bit earlier. And it was actually a two-part program, so there's a history theory class in the fall, and then the research studio in the spring. And I think it has influenced my research in the sense that I've become extremely interested in the research-based studio as a framework for generating research that will be published, and to think about how that pedagogical model can be combined with faculty research agendas and turned into public scholarship. And it's something that I'm trying to pursue further now. I think I've been, you know, inspired by the Mellon program, and I've been thinking about ways to intervene in this. I did want to say also just the difficult role of the Mellon program, that, you know, there's an enormous amount of work and patience and effort involved in making these classes work, because you have to really try and understand where people are coming from. So it's not just about the disciplines, it's about their embodied knowledge and experience. And Angela actually brought that up. You know, these people who have real connections to places like Mexico City that changes the way they see the discipline. So all that has been very formative in my kind of rethinking of interdisciplinarity. But I think I would like to develop a model where that kind of process of trying to understand people's assumptions and the framework for how you do this kind of work is developed more fully in a kind of experimental participatory model in the semester preceding the class, so that you can actually work out a pedagogical framework with the students who are involved and draw on their interests, and then transform that into a collective process of scholarship with the students and faculty and outside visitors working together on it. And then the third part would be the public component of it, which is also, I think, a really big contribution of the Mellon, that there's always, like we have here today, this public dimension to it. And I think that's an incredibly strong part of the program. And it does actually, I'm not sure about people developing a common, when you're asking about the common language, I think that's very challenging. But I think the impulse to produce the public discourse at the end brings people into a kind of collective language that's very, very helpful. So those three things, I think, and how they work together have influenced me. Yeah.
My name is Ronald Vail. I am a professor in architecture, and I taught sensing cityscapes with Professor Greg Nehemiah in our practice, and more recently, affordable urbanism with Stephanie Sukoko. Last year, and I would say that you know, the class both grew from my research, but I think was altered by research, especially in the context of the political landscape that we are in right now, that surrounds the understanding of walls, but also delving into a new way of thinking about walls, and particularly the urban typology, which we call border wall urbanism, that there is a city that's defined by walls, and what kind of city is that? What does that mean to be a city defined by walls? But I also think it allowed me to more clearly define a particular type of methodology. So if architects have a methodology that goes from, let's say, analysis to proposal to application, if you're lucky, right, the application of buildings, I think this class has allowed me to understand that you could do that in reverse. I think we did that in the Sensing Cityscapes, but that you can actually take the field work and think about application as a strategy to uncover what the city needs. And so this was, I think, challenging for students, but also I think that challenge really allowed me to open up to new possibilities of making. And in combination with that, in parallel to that, working with Professor Michael Deere on an exhibition that's now at Richmond Art Center, which I think the folding of all these components really enriched my experience and the students' experience.
Okay, hi. So I'm Stephanie Seabrook. I'm an assistant professor in art and practice. And so we team taught this course. It hadn't existed before. It was called Border Wall Urbanism. And I think the most important thing was literally, you know, as we were developing it, things were changing so quickly. And so to, you know, to kind of field student concerns and issues and also on the ground problematics, I think was, you know, it was definitely unusual in the sense that, you know, maybe in other fields you're able to kind of take a step back, you can analyze, or you have time to kind of, you know, prepare. So in general, my takeaway though, I'm that weird artist kind of professor in the sense that I think the assumption a lot of students had coming into the class was that art is a kind of reactive space, that what it does is it reflects on, as opposed to actually becomes an active, you know, protagonist of a situation. So that was an interesting kind of challenge, and it also helped me realize that in order to kind of better frame to non-arts practitioners what our value is, that we had to kind of switch language a little bit more. So, you know, art as not just being an aesthetic or a kind of decorative or, you know, passive reflection, but something that actually, you know, is a powerful instigator. So I think that I also teach social practice courses in the undergraduate art department, and my prior experience is also working with the Big Ideas Collaborative Innovation class. We collaborated with business majors, or I'm sorry, business professors in theater, dance, and performance, and that was also an interesting way to figure out how do you challenge student notions of art. And I think, you know, you're kind of in that same field too, because you straddle both those territories. But, you know, looking around when I see these posters, I'm so excited to see art embedded in so much of the work. And I do wonder how the non-art practitioners wind up coming away, you know, from that experience.
So I'm filling in for Erica Chong-Shuck because unfortunately she's ill, and also for Diego Di Tommaso. And the three of us together taught the first undergraduate studio, which was called SiteWorks, Understanding Place Through Design and Performance. And this course, I think, represents kind of the culmination of work that Diego and Erica started in their placemaking and performance course, and in courses that I taught, including Cities and Bodies and Mapping City Stories. And I can speak not to the research so much as to how teaching these courses affected the practices of Erica Gigo and myself, since all of us consider ourselves primarily practitioners rather than scholars. And after teaching the first course, Erica and Gigo went on to create a major performance that took place in San Francisco and all over the Marin Headlands that explored public space in a very deep way and has become a multi-year project. So I would say that their work in teaching here at Berkeley has gone out into the world in a very concrete way and helped a lot of people think about public space. And in the same way, I would say that my work with Erica and Gigo and other projects that I've done out at the Bulb in association with the Global Urban Humanities Initiative has done exactly what Ron described, which is instead of doing the typical city planner march through site analysis, you know, existing conditions, development of alternatives, you know, public process, you choose a plan, then you implement it, you you start with just making something in public space. And so I would say that all of my experiences here at Global Urban Humanities have been enormously important in my community activism. My practice is basically community activism, and in the 30 public events that we've put on at the Ball in the last couple of years, the framework of what everybody has been doing has taken, I think, what we're doing beyond the urban prototyping movement, which the way Ron described, you know, starting with an intervention and moving backwards from that. There are aspects of that that correspond to urban prototyping, but we've seen that there are problems, particularly in terms of equity and justice, in the urban prototyping world. And I think that all of the work that everybody's been doing in all the studios and the theory classes has given us the start of a more meaningful discussion of what placemaking and just placemaking is, and I think is affecting practice in the world, because I know that a number of students have gone out to create and make interventions even outside of their classes, and they're taking with them the theoretical and the more thoughtful background that I think humanities have brought to when it is purely a design intervention, can be lacking in reflection.
So another question, what makes interdisciplinary teaching work well?
Just go back to sort of expand on what I was saying earlier. I think a lot of it has to do with a lot of talking with the people that you're working with, because you have to. I can say when we were doing our studio, we spent the summer putting together the reading list. So there were three of us, Angela, Maria, and I, who brought different readings to the syllabus. And we thought we understood each other's intellectual position, but then when we got in the classroom and started talking with the students, we realized that we really didn't. And we had these really interesting non-alignments that just occurred again and again, right? And I actually think those are the most productive part of the whole thing, that we aren't actually trying to look for a kind of unified knowledge, but it's the collisions and the gaps. And I started to think of what we were producing as this weird thing, you know, held together with intellectual duct tape and glue and stuff, pieced together, you know, and we had partial language that was very contingent on who was there. And we gradually started to get a picture of what that was by the end. But of course, the next time you do it, it's going to be different again, right? It's not going to be the same thing. And there's an incredible richness in that that is something you don't encounter in kind of regular teaching effort. So, but it requires this huge amount of effort, interpersonal effort, and discussion and conversation, right? And then you really get to know the other people. So that's why it's like time consuming, and there's lots of confusion. And I think there's affect in it too, anger, and, you know, other things I'm not being understood, you know.
I think that, excuse me, the whole interdisciplinarity thing also has surprising outcomes, which is, I think, for all of our students, it made them recognize their own disciplinarity, and it really strengthened it in a positive way. Because of their interactions with these other disciplines, it made them understand, and we have a lot of, most of our PhD students are coming from design backgrounds, which we're kind of dropping because they're moving into this new more scholarly arena. But I think that they started to actually appreciate certain aspects of that background. And one of the most interesting, I think, divisions that emerged was between, say, the architects and the MFA students in both studios who just do stuff, and how difficult that is for people coming from other disciplines. And so that is a major division, because they're just used to producing things off the bat. And so they jump right in. Also, the time commitment. I think that art students and former architecture students have a completely different idea of how many hours you need to put in, and it's way more. than in other disciplines. Plus, it's very product oriented. You have less control over your own time in a way. And so that was something that was really important to understand, that was just the way that they had been taught. It's much more time consuming, I would say. You really have to spend the summer before talking through what you're doing to make sure you're kind of on the same page. But in a way, these opposing or kind of not aligned perspectives are rich, and the students really then have to engage with them. So I think that's a super productive aspect of this kind of interdisciplinary teaching.
I actually think that Ron and I, even though, you know, he's CED and I'm art practice, we actually had a lot of overlaps, more than differences. And so what was interesting was that in the beginning, we had 18 students sign up for Border Wall Urbanism, which was a studio course. So, you know, we had to do these pretty ambitious projects at three different sites on the US-Mexico border over the semester. And what invariably happened, unfortunately, is within the first week or two, all the general humanities students dropped out because they didn't want to make things. They didn't want to go through that studio process and the rigor, and it really freaked them out. So in the end, we had mostly art and architecture and landscape architecture students left, and because that's what they were comfortable with. So it's interesting to try to think about, you know, how to bridge that fear of this whole other world of making, and maybe you can speak a little bit more about that.
Yeah, I don't know if I can speak more. That wasn't the case in the first version of the course I taught in fifth grade Nehemiah. I think there was a larger interdisciplinary group. I don't know if it's normal or abnormal if students do that, but that was certainly the case. But I would say, echoing what Margaret said, is that their own interdisciplinarities came out, like Sam Gibb, was here earlier. I think she's going to present something, but I was very interested in dance, and I think she's gravitating and moving in that direction now, taking a class in the theater department. And I saw more of that the graphic designer part would come out, or the housing person, housing background would come out. And so these would be revealed. But I would say, you know, I agree about our overlap. I would say there wasn't friction. When I thought about this class, I really wanted to learn from Stephanie. Like I said, I want to know how Stephanie thinks, and I explicitly, that's what I was interested in as a kind of research. I was researching you. I think that as a form of interest, I think for me at least, allowed this collaboration to be really enriching from my viewpoint. And I think that appreciation led into the students as well. I think that they really understood that this was kind of a joint effort, that I felt.
Yeah. I was the only person on this panel teaching an undergraduate course, and I would say I think that the interdisciplinary work is much easier with undergraduates because they're not yet in their silos and they're still very open. We had 16 students from, I think, 12 different departments, and mostly not CED, and they were probably down to do whatever. And I would say it was interesting just to think of perceptions among the instructors of what the rhythm of the semester is, which in a studio course, in a city planning studio course, which I'm very familiar with, you know, there are certain milestones of pinups and reviews, and kind of know what needs to be done at what time. So it was very interesting for me to be working with a choreographer and theater director who had her own idea of when you start closing down, right? In any of these processes, you open up and let loose and you're kind of just playing, and then eventually you have to narrow and decide what you're going to do and come up with the work product. And so for me, it was hard to stay open and loose and kind of as undefined. You know, we did a lot of great rolling around on the floor and shouting and, you know, all kinds of. So I was really wanting to learn from Erica. Oh yeah, it was good stuff.
Rolling around in pine needles.
Yeah, rolling around outdoors, and it was all very instructive. But eventually, I said, "Where are we going to go the graphic scale has to be accurate. Yes, scale matters. And I think Erica found this quite square, literally. I think it was very, very defined. And so that tension between the two was super interesting. Just the rhythm of creating a performance is very different from the rhythm of creating a design proposal or a site analysis poster. And so that element of rhythm and time was super interesting.
Questions?
So out of the 12 students that we had, a number of them are actually from the borderlands, had grown up, had, you know, very firsthand experience of it. And I think that also changed the dynamic of the course. Because in other words, like, it wasn't just students, you know, examining something apart or other from them. And it was an interesting mix of students because then they could learn off of each other and also not just have us be the conduit of that knowledge. So I think what's important is to, you know, since some other people have pointed this out before, that there is a kind of odd ethnographic component to taking a well-funded, wealthy, you know, group of students to a place to then examine and come up with, you know, responses to that. So I think we were really lucky with our makeup of students.
But I think that your question is also talking about referring to the act of making and the difficulties of making, and I think there's always inherent fears of technologies. For example, like we did wood shop, like welding, and this, I think this was new to students, and laser cutting was a tutorial to students, and they had access to these labs. And within that, there was the notion that you're going to use these tools and you're going to make things, and these things are going to be big. And I fear that that was daunting to some students, that they looked at that and said, oh my gosh, well, you know, they had a comfortable space within their own disciplines, and this was maybe too much of a radical departure. And so maybe in a future class, there's some way to ease students into that world so that it doesn't seem like a barrier.
Yeah, we had, we actually divided the students into pairs, Tiana was saying that. So we would have people with different kinds of expertise looking at one of the material conditions. And that kind of intimate relationship in the classroom, I think, helped, you know, display some of the anxiety about approaching something you hadn't done before. But we also, I think, took the standpoint from the beginning that we weren't going to try to turn the students into something else. So we tried to find where their passion and commitment was and got them to bring that to the table with the other students and talk it through. So that was, you know, somewhat of a different way of doing it, I think, probably.
I don't really have anything to say in answer to you, but I feel that actually going over the experiences and trying to learn from what happened is really valuable in crafting this kind of pedagogical format. And I do think it's one of the best pedagogical formats around that can really, is very capacious. It can accommodate all kinds of faculty, all kinds of students, and be shaped in a number of different ways to address different topics. So to me, it is like the commitment to a studio is much more than just going to a class. The idea that there is some kind of product is really helpful. And the range of different studios that have been held is quite remarkable. So I feel that this is actually a new and really positive format that needs to be kind of promoted, and even like to have some kind of product of all of the studios together, demonstrating that this is a valuable type of format.
Just one thing to say. I really appreciate your formulation of the city as source of knowledge and not just as object of study, and it's kind of an aha for me, because I think that's what a lot of our studios have been, especially when you look at, you know, your theme of materiality in Mexico City, that starting from both the things and the people, and the city as a source of knowledge about many things and not just about itself, I think that that's what's really valuable. And it was really helpful to me to be working with an archaeologist, with our great GSI, at a place like the Albany Bowl or anywhere in the city, to work with an archaeologist side where the materials speak and are the source of knowledge, just as the people who are often ignored, vulnerable people or people considered others, such as the homeless community that had been in the Albany Bowl, even though we chose not to do interviews with those folks, still that knowledge. So they were considered not an object of study, but rather a source of knowledge. But if you're approaching something not as the object of study and coming at it with a set of methods, then the methods are necessarily going to be messier. And if you think of source in the sense of like a spring, you know, if the source is emitting water or a spring, it's harder to control. And so I think that's part of the excitement, but also the messiness of what we've been doing.
I'd like to ask the panel, please, to come back to this question of resistance among students in particular, but also amongst faculty, perhaps. The reason for asking this question is because in the early years, the first year in this city of moving image class, which is a really good class, which I taught with Ray Hombau on film, it was hard. It was the earliest years, and looking at what's being done now, it's streaks ahead of what we were doing in the early days when we were very young. But the point that I'm getting to is that in 18 or 20 students that started, 8 dropped out very soon, and the 8 people who dropped out were people from the CED, from environmental design, and the majority, except for one, stayed in were from humanities, a wide range of disciplines. That was disappointing for me personally, but obviously you have to roll the punches. And what I didn't expect then was a degree of resistance to the kind of thing that I was interested in conveying to the students, coming from a different background, you understand. I thought I was bringing something to the class, but I was bringing something that they didn't want. And the only way it was resolved in the end was almost like by fear, Greg, rather than collaborating and sitting down and saying, who are you, tell me who you are, and I think, bam, this is what we're going to do. And what we were going to do was actually produce something. You know, it didn't matter what you were going to do, you were going to make something. And that ultimately turned out to be the most liberating thing, because the majority of students from the humanities community were interested in talking and not doing. When confronted with the problem of doing something, they actually rose to the occasion dramatically well. And in fact, they were very relieved, because Ray Hong and I were no longer dithering about what this class was doing, but there was a form, there was a purpose, and it was not writing yet another term paper or something like that. So it was. But the question I have for you is how to overcome that resistance. Because Greg is a nice guy, I'm not so nice as him. And my approach is by fear, his is by persuasion, I think. So can you say more about any experiences you guys have had about resistance and how you've overcome it? Greg's already said something, but or was it just me?
Right.
I have been reflecting on this for a really long time. There was lots of kinds of resistance in the class, and it's something I'm still trying to grapple with, because the nature of the class was resistance towards a particular topic in some ways, right? There's a wall. How does design and art become valid forms of activism? Whatever side you're on, it's open, but the resistance was redirected at times by students in really interesting ways. I actually remember the very first assignment. One response to the assignment was, well, assignments are colonialist enterprises, and therefore I'm resisting the assignment.
Yeah.
I thought, wow, okay. What do you do? If that's the starting point, where do you go from there? You know, and I think my reaction to that, well, I don't know if it was a healthy reaction or a good reaction, I did not know how to react, but maybe I reacted more like you would react. Like, what does this offer the rest of the classes? Like, how does your reaction become a source of knowledge? And that's what I threw back to the student, and then I'm not sure where it went from there, but I think creative people resist fundamentally. And I think in some ways it's an instructor's responsibility to talk about where to direct resistance in work. And I would like to think it's not within the pedagogy necessarily, but it should be as well in a healthy way. But just how to direct resistance is.
But if just to follow it up and reframe a question, if the resistance takes the form of not coming to the studio, of dropping out after a couple of weeks, you don't have the opportunity to redirect it. It's gone. It's not there. And so I want to offer my hypothesis that some of what we're seeing goes beyond the difference or the tensions between the talking and writing disciplines and the making disciplines. And it has to do with risk aversion. As an institution, we attract students, undergraduates and graduates, who are really smart, really bright, but also really successful. And the other side of success is a kind of form of risk avoidance that can be somewhat limiting. So I just wonder, are there strategies, maybe this is already thinking about where we go from here a little bit, but in any case, are there strategies to encourage students to take risks that would lead them to believe that this may not be a complete failure, and that whatever they think of as the requirements for success may not be such? Because I do think that part in the self-selecting process, we're witnessing the kind of risk avoidance that mostly leads students to be successful in the things they choose.
One strategy we had them do a lot of projects to the point where it was actually, it might have been too much. I mean, you know, so in other words, they're like, they're doing something, it didn't work out, oh well, you know, next thing. Not like they were encouraging failure, but I think some of the other classes that might be framed around just one giant project might, you know, have that more. Yeah, and then you have to get it right, you know. So our series of steps, I think, made them go through lots of processes before we finally tackled the larger issues.
Yeah. We also had this great opportunity to work and to see the work of artists who visited the studio or visited their studios, who were taking enormous risks in that work. And I thought that was really healthy for them to go there and say, oh my God, you failed so many times, or you just got on a plane and went somewhere and did something because you had this idea overnight. I think those were helpful moments for students to realize they take big risks.
Yeah, I think that I actually think one thing that happened in the program were these the info sessions that happened before the courses began, because you're able to really talk with students about what's going to happen and integrate into the idea that there will be conflict and dialogue around various points, right? And I think that's really, really important. But we had some incredibly tense arguments in the class. I wouldn't call them resistance. I would call them just big arguments, and they lasted the whole semester. And I think I'm an optimist. I feel like you have to embrace these things and see them as productive and have a generosity towards positions that you don't agree with. So one of the big points was about identity politics, because it was a transnational studio, and students who lived in the US, had been schooled in Chicano studies and other things, had a very particular model of the meaning of race in Mexico City versus people who were from Mexico City who joined the class later on, right? And that is very threatening to people, to have the basis of what you think your political position in the academy is sort of pulled out from under your feet. It could be seen that way, but that's what's happening. And we just chose to embrace this and accept the two different positions and have them talk with each other. And that became a way into a whole series of scholarly issues about the way the epistemology of identity is being treated now versus, you know, two decades ago or whatever, right? So I think it's just all to do with having a generosity towards the argument and allowing that to continue. But I do think those, I don't know if you had that thing, Michael, where you talked to students before the course started.
Because I remember my strategy was to bring you into the classroom and control my students.
Right, I remember that. but you know, that wasn't the end. I was just thinking of the, you know, before. So anyway, Margaret.
Yeah, we also had many assignments, and we were very, I guess, generous in assessing them. The main thing was to have students all do the same thing a lot of times, so they could just get comfortable doing things. And I think that was very positive. I mean, and I guess it could be criticized as being what ethnography light. And in fact, one of our most interesting discussions was about Enterprise edited video. And the anthropologists were outraged that he had actually edited it. In order to make it be more coherent, to make more sense, etc. They were really outraged by that. But I think that turned out to be a really productive discussion too. So if everybody is out there doing something, maybe it's ethnography light, but it actually generates good discussions about how you do these things. And also it forces students to do them here's one after the other. If it didn't work out, you just move on to the next assignment. And I think that's a very productive way, instead of being, you know, grade them. I mean, we didn't even grade them, we just did them. And I think that removed a lot of resistance.
I just wanted to say one other thing, because I think the room that we had is different now. It's been renovated, and yes, it's very nice. Like, I think we had 491.
Yeah.
But we put all the tables together in the center of the room at the beginning, and that actually became, I remember some of the students who came into the class didn't know what studio, really didn't understand the studio experience at all, but the thing of working around the table on their different projects is incredibly helpful. Having a room there and available all the time went a long way towards building this kind of solidarity amongst the students, and that also helps with the resistance issue, because they start to think they're part of one thing, even though they have very different positions. There's a collective discourse going on.
And actually, after the faculty leave, if they're in the room, the important things happen then.
Yeah, that we don't know about.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, we have to acknowledge that we're asking students to take emotional risks as well as intellectual risks. And the space is really important. And the relationship of the students' bodies to each other is important. And in our case, with SiteWorks, we were itinerant. We didn't really have a set classroom. And one-third of our classes were in an acting studio, one-third were out at the site, and one-third, or not even one-third, we had to use the library instructional room because we had no classroom. So we were kind of lugging stuff around and moving people, and that experience kind of matched the unsettled nature of our object of study, the bowl. I think in a way it was difficult, but it built a kind of solidarity, even though we missed the opportunity to have that shared space. But I think also one thing I've learned from working with the choreographers, we did a lot of physical from our first meeting, we were just sitting, students came in and they sat in a circle on the floor, and we did a lot of bodily exercises that, you know, maybe that would scare away some students in the first session, but you know, we didn't lose any students over the course of the semester. It was amazing. And I think we were partly lucky. There were an amazing group that's also different with undergrad. grads, but I think doing those kind of risky, emotionally and physically risky exercises as an integral part of the course, as you know, a means of inquiry that we were going to use at the site as well, but that built a kind of trust among the students themselves and among the between them and the instructors that was helpful. And I just want to ask Annie, because Annie heard more as the GSI about what was really going on. And so I think, you know, more than any of us ever really hear from students, you heard, you know, what they were really feeling. And you also took a course that was a graduate course with Erica and Kiko, where I think there was a lot of kind of trust that built up in that class and risk-taking even with those graduate students. So I wonder if you have any perspectives.
And while this will be the last comment.
Why?
Don't hold back. Don't censor
yourself. Oh, I never do. I think you hit the nail on the head in terms of, especially for undergraduate students, being somewhat risk averse and also wanting a lot of structure, and their training gives them sort of an entitlement to that structure in terms of, you know exactly what's going to happen in a course at the beginning of the year. It follows, it proceeds according to the syllabi. You know when you can skip something and when you can't. Learn very quickly what's important and what's not, and sort of how to operationalize it and make it more efficient. And so all of these courses, and that's not exclusive to undergraduates either, all of these courses push against that that efficiency, because they're not efficient at all in my experience being part of the planning process of them, in the collaborative nature of the courses, and in the students' experience of, well, what am I getting out of this? What's the, you know, they don't use the language of learning objectives, but from the pedagogy I've taught as a graduate student, you know, you have your learning objectives and you attach it. And we did those exercises, but the students lose sight of it in the messiness of, you know, experience, which is the strength of it. And I think also from the graduate student perspective, one of the other risks you're asking people to take can verge on tokenism in a certain way. If you're asking, you know, you have 12 different students from 12 different disciplines, and the anthropologists in the room feel they must protect the sanctity of the interview as a form. And I think that's one of the strengths of the courses, is that you try to break that down. So I think there's always going to be resistance to these forms of classes, and that part of that, as Ron and Stephanie both pointed out, that's part of using it well, as opposed to easing the pain.
as much as I've been reflecting on the resistance that exists in the class, I'm looking over at the monitor and seeing the students' work, which is there in full dress rehearsal mode, wearing medieval attire against the border wall under the watchful eye of border patrol agents, and said these guys took enormous risks in making this film production. And so I think at the moment they wanted to take away, they found the right risk for themselves, they went for it.
Have they been released from prison yet?
Okay, thank you all so much.